What I would like to do now is to give you some, or to say something about the history, about the empires on the Silk Road. And
1 minute. Do you like to record it, or it's just it's okay to for speaking?
It's recorded for the module.
Yeah, okay.
That's okay. May I?
And
sorry.
Put it in your pocket, maybe, or something. Sorry.
Yeah. And give some associations about the connection of history, the empires on the Silk Road, and religion. Who are the protagonists on the Silk Road in the course of the history? Some words to the most important ancient periods and powers. Rome. Even if the direct Silk Road connection didn't lead to Rome, if we have a look on a map, so that's anyway the, yeah, that's the title.
You could be bigger.
If we have a look on a map of the year 200 AD, we see that the Roman and the Chinese Empire are the poles of the Eurasian continent. Also we have the Roman Empire here and the Han Dynasty in the east. Carthage, Carthago in German, developed from a Phoenician, at the latest after the Roman victory over Carthage, Rome became an ancient superpower. Carthage developed from a Phoenician colony to the most important trading center in the Mediterranean. The Phoenician city-states in the Levant were most important trading centers in the ancient world, with a network in all directions. Phoenicia was, in fact, what is today Lebanon, here in this area. Till the first century, before BC, Rome became the heir of the Hellenistic Diadochi states, which developed after Alexander's death and took the political leadership in Asia Minor and Palestine. It was in this time when silk became one of the most wanted luxury goods in Rome. And the way, especially of women, to dress with silk did not find favor in Roman conservative traditional circles of the Senate. Besides the scandals around transparent clothing, it became an economic question. There's a very famous citation of Plinius the Elder. Lowly estimated, India, the Sahara, and Arabian Peninsula annually receive 100 million sesterces through our empire. So much does our luxury and our women cost us. Not only, but especially the silk trade became the economical standard issue in the Roman and Persian relations. Rome and China, like other Eastern people, knew from each other, but the Persians managed to keep the monopoly on intermediary trade via the control of the trade routes, which already Ammianus Marcellinus described as a long trade road of the Seres, or silk people. He means the Chinese. With the influence of the Persians, a lot in the Chinese-Roman relation remained deliberately mythological. But it is worth noting that Chinese called Rome for a certain time Dakin. I'm not sure about it. It means the bigger China or the other China. Maybe it relates also to that the Romans are taller than Chinese people, I'm not sure. Dakin. Later, Ctesiphon, the capital of Persian, of the Parthian Empire, was also called Dakin. Especially when Rome temporarily won the overhand over Persia or Parthia, they were trying to open direct relations. But with the Sasanian assumption of power in the 3rd century, these contexts seem to have been declined again. China. The innovation of silk production has extraordinary meaning for the Chinese culture, economy, and policy. Silk was not only textile, it pacified barbarians in difficult times. There's a famous citation, which I have from a, no, I didn't brought the books, from a lecture from Mr. Kuhlke, and he says the he brought the citation about the Xiuang, the barbarians or so-called barbarians in the north, and the Chinese. And the Chinese for a long time had to pay tribute. And the ambassador is interrupted by Xi Yuan saying, don't make too much words. Pay the silk, give the weapons, what other things are to say? If the weapons are in good conditions, if the silk is enough, everything is set and your business is done. Otherwise, our riders will come and take your harvest next autumn. It was considered as currency, so silk was considered as currency, and it was the material which gave not only the trade route in the West, but also the producers its name, if you have seen. If we remember the words of Ammianus Marcellinus, as a real deliberately planned east-west connection, the so-called Silk Road, especially after Richthofen in the 19th century, it came to life after Chinese Han Emperor Wu sent Sun Qian to the west, his general. Sun Qian passed the Tarim Basin, the Tian Shan, after Fergana, Bactria, and Parthia. Mainly silk came from Chinese side, nefarit came from Khotan, horses from the steppe, glassware from the Mediterranean. And it's interesting how it shaped the direction of Chinese expansion. We see this this belt in a Han Empire, which is brown-orange here. And this belt is interesting. This is from the 1st century, but in most, maybe, important time in the Chinese history, in the 8th century, around 700, we have this belt again, when they won against the Gök Turks. But the parts of the trade route are much older. Herodot speaks about long-distance trade inhabited by the Scythians in the 5th century BC. And Peter and Reinicke was the first to show, based on a widespread presence of a particular type of art depicting animals, like deer, tiger, and so on, that there were contacts throughout the vast area from the Black Sea to China in the 7th to 4th century. Elena Kuzmina, in her book Prehistory of the Silk Road, writes, "At present, no doubt remains that some parts of the road began functioning as early as the Bronze Age. Lapis Lazuli went from Badakhshan, which is now northeast of Afghanistan, to Western Asia, Egypt, and India. Turquoise came from Sogdiana, which should be today Kazakhstan, also a part of Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, and with capitals like Samarkand and Bukhara. Relations were established between China and Transbaikalia. So the trade route existed already in the 3rd to 2nd millennium, when nefrit and lapis lazuli roads came into existence. Iran. We saw Rome and China as poles in a map before in Eurasia, on a Eurasian continent. Luce Boulnois, in her book, La Rue de la Soie, reversed to China and the Sassanian Persia as poles, also to China and Sassanian Persia. For the 7th century and beginning of the 8th century, this is well justified. Even if Persia was not the end of the trade routes, of course, which branched towards north, west, and south, especially in the area of the Transcaucasus, Iran was an uncontested lord of the intermediary trade. Byzantium paid over long periods annual tributes and was in the reign of Khosrow II, around 600, close to the edge of the abyss of its existence at all. The importance the Persians attached to the position becomes clear in an episode under Khosrow I. When a Sogdian embassy with a huge mass of silk was asking for entrance and passage to Persia, Khosrow lets him wait. Then he bought the whole charge and burned it in front of the eyes of the ambassadors, showing this has nothing, no value for us. The mentioned General Zhang Yan in the times of the Han in the first century would have reached in the West mission also the Roman border if Persians, merchants, wouldn't have told him that it is still another journey of long 2 years. In fact, it was 2 or 3 days. Arabs. Meanwhile, the Persians kept always good relations to China. The Arabs, after defeating and taking over the wide Persian Empire, followed another policy. The direct victory against the Tang Dynasty in 751 meant the Muslim domination of Transoxania and over the cities along the Silk Route, which was economically very beneficial. The Arabs controlled thus an area reaching from Morocco till the modern south of Kazakhstan. But the control over such wide areas along the Silk Route didn't last too long. There were rebellions against the Abbasid rule, and in the 9th century started the so-called Iranian Intermezzo, coined by Vladimir Minorsky, this term. And it means the Tahrirites, Safarids, Samanids, Bujids, etc. Till the emergence and rule of the Seljuk Turks in around 1100. Mongols. So now I need the book I brought. Yeah. Being ignorant, when I saw the title of this book of Peter Frankopan, I thought, oh, this must be a super detailed work about the Silk Road. And then I saw A New History of the World. So Peter Frankopan wrote a book, and as an anchor, as a base, he took this the Silk Road as a backbone in his book. It is not so detailed, in fact. And one of Peter Frankopan's chapters is titled The Road to Hell, and by himself after related very different. In other words, it is a Pax Mongolica. What the Arabs tried in an approach, but being still very far out of reach, the Mongols managed the control over the whole Silk Road. From the Chinese Sea to the Black Sea, to the Mediterranean, to the Baltic Sea. The reasons for the success led in a ruthless planning, the fierce and streamlined organization of the state, and the rigorous hierarchy, But that's not all. The Mongol Empire was a kind of absorption of the century-old traditions of empire building in the steppe before the Mongols and the perception of Chinese state organization, Chinese rule and self-image of the ruler, and last not least, material techniques of China. And in the person of Genghis Khan. Marco Polo gives a description, which you know for sure, of the organization of the post stations and messenger systems, best known probably to everybody here. An example of for the travel on the Silk Road is also the mission of the Franciscan monk William of Rubruck. Another example is given in Armenian history of the 13th century by the writer Kyriakos Gantzagetsi. When he describes in detail the travel of the Armenian king of Kilikia, Hatoum, who subjected to Mönke Khan. The ferocity of the conquest of cities which offered resistance is described by the same author, by Kyriakos, who describes in detail the conquest and destruction, for example, of Ani, the Armenian capital, and also from Baghdad, which is very famous. But the devastating actions are not chaotic, but characterized by precise organizations. Nearly the whole people of Baghdad are executed, and Kyriakos, after explaining that for 40 days the sword was ruling, and if the people were tired to execute, they hired others, although they killed everybody. And Kyriakos, after this explaining, he says, 500 years had elapsed since that city, Baghdad, he means, was built by the Ismailites in the time of Jaber, on the Tigris River above Ctesiphon, about 5 days' journey above Babylon. And it had taken everything into its kingdom like an insatiable bloodsucker, swallowing up the entire world, and it was destroyed, paying the blood price for the blood it has caused to flow and for the evil it had wrought. When its measure of sin was filled up before the omniscient God, he repaid it justly, strictly, and truthfully. And the arrogant and fanatical kingdom of the Tajiks, he means the Arabs, ended after a duration of 600 years, etc. So according to the Christian author, not the cruelty of Hülegü is responsible for the damage of the city, but the divine revenge. The destruction of Baghdad from Mongol contemporary perspective seems in accordance with their own principles. Resistance is punished with death, individually or collectively. The difference from Ani, from the capital of Armenia, and Baghdad is maybe in Ani, they choose artisans, young women, children, which had any value and killed only the others. The Pax Mongolica has in this way several aspects. The Mongols were definitely interested to benefit from the trade routes. Their lordship had to be accepted. Often the subjected princes or kings or religious leaders had to travel to Karakorum to show their subjection. Every resistance was ruthlessly eliminated. Cities which submitted in time were spared, normally. Even here are exceptions. Kyriakos Gantzagetsi narrates also the destroyed cities are rebuilt after destruction. And he relates to Armenian merchants which were highly promoted by the Khan governors. Having in mind this and the post system, it becomes clear the Mongols were as well destroyers and new builders. This is true even for Tamerlan, Timur-Lenk. In his time, destroying everything, the trade route worked. My second point, expansion and coincidentia oppositorum. It means the union of opposites. The Silk Road was, as is well known, a kind of reloading point of religions. Especially Nestorian Christians, Buddhists, Manichaeans, Jews, Muslims disseminated their form of cult and belief on the way to Asia and vice versa. Also princes and kingdoms became Christian, Buddhist, Muslim, Jewish. This reveals an interesting contradiction and this coincidentia oppositorum. The intention of prominent religious figures like Jesus or Siddhartha Gautama was to renew their own religious tradition in a, let's say, comprehensible and reasonable way. Their message and preaching was directed primarily to their own people and religious communities. Finding resonance and forming groups of followers in the Jewish respective Brahmanist society. The reform movements, however, didn't manage to convince the broad base of their communities or societies, as we know. However, becoming great communities or churches or military states like Muslim, they continued to expand across national borders along the Silk Road. So the Nestorian or Persian church spread from Mesopotamia to China. As well did the Buddhism in all directions. Their success becomes obvious in the religious talk on the courtyard of Mönke Khan, related by William of Rubruck. But the beliefs not only spread under the common people, it was much more effective to convince the kings themselves. Maybe the most bizarre was a convention of the Uyghur ruler Böge Khan to Manichaeism in the 8th century. The strict dualistic belief was mostly everywhere forbidden and damned. Werner Sundermann asked in his article Der Manichaeismus an der Seidenstraße, what was the reason for Böge Khan to convert to a religion saying to its believers that military service, hunting, taxes, killing even of insects would be a sin. Beside the indeed religious connected reason, it is the charisma of the apostle, the impression of power of his speech, and the spiritual purity. There are more political reasons which convert the later Emperor Constantine, for example, also the Emperor Constantine to Christianity, Chinese rulers to Buddhism, and the Arabs, which united under a simple moral religion of Islam, or the Khazar Khan to the Jew. Firstly, necessary was a religion with little national coined elements, acceptable so for different ethnics and traditions, simple and clear moral demands compatible to different cults. The new religion, in this way, should help connecting a multi-ethnic, a multi-traditional state. Secondly, a new cult should help also giving new rulers and dynasties the authority they were looking for. In the case of Böge Khan, there is the laconic remark that Manichaeism, already known to the Uyghur people and having followers along the Silk Road, was the only remaining of the renowned beliefs like Christianity or Jewish or Buddhist, which was applicable and which remained to discern from the other powers. An essential point to add is that missionaries tried to make their belief comprehensible in other cultural contexts, becoming so still more compatible between each other. Again, in summarizing, the big trade routes had the biggest meaning for the spread of different beliefs. The fact that revolutionary ideas to reform cult system in Brahman and Jewish society expanded and became new religions and state instruments. By this development, new sophisticated cult forms and practices, often the opposite of the original ideas, is the coincidentia oppositorum. And the Silk Route was a most important condition for this development. The same is true for the expansion of states and empires. What I suggest here is a kind of of change of perspective. Yes, the Chinese and Persian and Roman Empire built streets and great routes. Not vice versa. It means not a route we're building the empires. But once built, the new power would have been forced to occupy the route in its length. Otherwise, it run into danger that other powers will use the economic and military potential. So the invasion and occupation of most as possible of the route was not pure greed. It was necessary. So the route, or the road, so the road develops an own dynamic, forcing the powers to occupy it, making them to players and changing protagonists. Itself remained constant as a road or Silk Road. Maybe at last. No, this is the wrong direction. When I was in Venice, one of the most suggestive palaces is this one, the Palazzo Mastelli del Camello. And three brothers being merchants. And the relief, which you see here, from the near looks like this. A camel transporting goods. And this is maybe the last association I will give you. Thanks.